I hurt myself today to see if I still feel. I focus on the pain, the only thing that's real.
And now the last track of The Downward Spiral. This is maybe when the credits are rolling on the protagonist's life, you know, kind of like an epilogue where he gets a chance to reflect on his life and what it meant. He also delivers this sort of seemingly posthumous apology to the people that he's hurt and the people that he's lost. And with a lot of Nine Inch Nails songs, I find there to be a lot of darkness. I think that's one of the reasons that we all really love this music and are drawn to this music, is because there's this like reflection of the darkness within us. But I always feel like there's a glimmer of hope in every Nine Inch Nails song. There's always just a little bit of light peeking through. If you're new to my channel, just so you know, I'm not a lyric analyzer, so I'm mostly going to be analyzing the harmony and the rhythms and the production elements and how that supports the narrative. But I am aware that this song obviously had a huge cultural impact as well, so if you're interested in learning more about it, I highly recommend reading the book by Adam Steiner on the Downward Spiral called Into the Never. And earlier this year, there was an incredible Song Exploder episode on Netflix that Mike James Gallagher, the sound designer who guested on my video about reptile sound design, he worked on that episode. And it is so good. I've watched it twice in a row. I was obsessed with The Downward Spiral when I first got it. I think I was around 15 years old and I was in a dark place myself, but also had a glimmer of hope at all times. And this album really resonated with me. I listened to it constantly. But this track never really did it for me at that time. Now I get it, but I really didn't back then. And part of it was because there was this one discordant note that would just jump out and assault me. And I really couldn't get past it. I remember thinking, why is he doing this? Why? It was so beautiful. He made it so ugly. Of course, these are just really kind of close-minded, you know, juvenile thoughts of a younger version of myself. Now, however, I understand why it's there, so much so that it's really important to me. And when a musician covers the song and takes that note out, I understand why they did that, but I feel that loss. To me, that's like the hurt note. But before we get to the harmony, let's look at this very first sound that we hear, because this is basically like the soundtrack to the song. This is going during the entire song. To me, it's kind of reminiscent of like the lonely tone in the beginning of the Downward Spiral title track, and also sort of the exhale feeling I get at the very beginning of A Warm Place. And there's this hollowness to it, this sort of isolation, this loneliness. It's like the sound of atmosphere or something, or like the tone of the universe, you know, the way the universe is vibrating. And it has this like, it feels like it transports me. It's sound design, you know? And then listen to the way it sounds like the verse is just like breaking down before our ears. In fact, with headphones on, it's kind of difficult to listen to.
I hurt myself today to see if I still feel. I focus on the pain. The only thing that's real.
Trent Reznor's sense of harmony in general, but specifically in this album, always seems to be kind of dancing between these very like whole, pure, lighter harmonies and these more complex, confused, uncertain, even uncomfortable, tense, and darker harmonies. Now, before we go and figure out what the chord progression is, figure out what these chords are, figure out his vocal melodies and how that relates to the chords, I find it's really useful to determine what the tonal center is, what the key is. And that's because it gives meaning, or a certain kind of meaning, to all of the chords and the notes. Everything's sort of in relationship to the tonal center. And what I mean by tonal center is that that's the place harmonically, like the chord you could think of, or the note, that everything really wants to return to. It's like the sun, and it's sucking everything into its orbit. Sometimes in music, the tonal center is obscured, and it's ambiguous, and it's hard to tell, almost like there are multiple places where we belong. So my working theory of the key of this song is that it's in B minor with a couple of rogue notes, and then modulating to D major for the chorus. Now, these two keys have a really interesting relationship. They are what are called relative keys. And what that means is that B minor shares all the same notes as D major, and therefore all the same chords. It's just that we've decided that in B minor, this is the tonic, and in D major, this is the tonic. So we can basically have like a minor key and that minor feeling, which can be kind of dark, more melancholic, a little more complicated, a little colder, and then the major tonality, which can sound brighter and a little bit more hopeful and, you know, maybe a little bit stronger, a little more triumphant, a little more certain. But it's almost like they're still the same thing. It's just a different expression. Almost like they're two different universes, but like, I was going to say parallel universes, but I guess relative universes, right? So what this means is that all of the notes and chords in B minor are shared with D major, but it's like they have different jobs. Just like if you were a person that was going between these two universes, you would still be the same you, but you might be have a different meaning to that society, or literally have a different job. So the three chords that I think make up the verse are a B minor sharp 11, then a D sus 2, and then a E 7. But I find it really helpful to kind of strip things down to just the three-note triad that's sort of implied underneath all of this complexity. So let's look at what that would be. I think it would be a B minor, then a D major, and an E major. Actually, the way it's voiced reminds me more of a pianist, I know I'm biased, sort of outlining a chord with their left hand, leaving out the third, like this.
I hurt myself today.
This first chord is the one that stings. This is the one that has the wrong note in it. It almost feels like it's broken. Sometimes voiced like this. Sometimes voiced like this. And there is some really interesting dissonance happening just within that chord. And then you add his voice on top of it and it gets even tenser. So that one note that sticks out is the F natural. It doesn't feel like it's supposed to be there. So a few things I'm noticing. First of all, there's a tritone that's created, or sometimes I call it a Trent tone because of the way that he is so dedicated to using this interval that's been sort of, whoa, this interval that often feels uncomfortable, or it's used to sort of bridge the gap between chords, but that's not how he uses it. He like embraces its ugliness and its awkwardness, and he highlights it and gives it a platform. We're left with that. It's like he wants this brokenness to have space, to just be. And I'm also hearing there's a major seventh here, which is also very, very dissonant. This interval is kind of what is making things feel so weird to me, because he's singing the F sharp at the same time as this F up here happens. So we have I. Do you hear that?
I.
It's like we took the F sharp and lowered it. We darkened it. And that's clashing with sort of the lightness of his I. The next chord is a lot more pleasing, and it's basically a D chord, just a D5, no major third, with a suspended 2 or add 9, however you want to think about it. And that's leading us to the next chord, which is some kind of E chord. And I think it's like a E7, like a dominant seventh chord. That's how I would like analyze it, but I'm here to tell you that it doesn't feel like that. That feels more like it started out as an E chord, and then halfway up, it gave up, relegated itself to falling back down to the tonic, to this place. If this chord was trying to function as a dominant seventh chord, first of all, I think we'd have the third, because that's a really important part of what makes a dominant chord sound dominant. An E chord and half of the tonic chord, the B minor chord. That D being the minor third of the tonic chord. So in contrast to this D, he ends some of the phrases in the vocal melody with a D sharp. It's just a half step difference. And he can kind of get away with it because he's singing kind of softly in his lower register and in a kind of breathy way. But if I sing it up an octave, you'll be able to hear exactly what I'm talking about. Today. There's like a lift there. There's that sort of hope, and it's that light. But then on top of that, at the same time, we have this darkness. Today, day. It's just so interesting to hear them happening at exactly the same moment. I did not hear it that way for decades. I think it was probably in the last year that I actually realized he is singing that major third. He's singing the D sharp. But pretty much every other cover that I've heard sings the D natural. So I know that I'm not alone in this sort of wishful hearing. Transition from the verse into the chorus is done mostly by way of his vocal melody. So instead of kind of resolving back to B, he kind of ends on A. Everything. And that's where the chord goes too. So that's a really nice place. And he's telling us right away, like, this is going to be a spot for us. Everything. This is where things are going to begin and end. And we're about to see just how important this A and E become. Everything is sort of pulsing on the quarter notes. It's very simple. It's very accessible. It could feel kind of like a heartbeat. There are no sudden moves here, right? But also, each one of these chords gets their own measure. So it's very evenly distributed. Progression is so incredibly beautiful and touching. And I don't have to tell you that. I mean, just watch some of this live performance. When that chord progression starts, people start cheering. It feels like triumphant. It feels like a celebration of humanity, you know, both like the good and the bad all at once. What I find so striking about it is its simplicity, its innocence. You know, there's nothing in here that's uncomfortable. There is some tension, but this feels so purely beautiful, and it's so cool to think that an entire fandom that is like, you know, just eating up Mr. Self-Destruct and the Broken EP and all these weird noises and this sonic chaos is weeping at the feet of this very simple pop progression. Trent Reznor often will end up obscuring the true quality of a chord by removing the third, or, you know, only playing some of the notes in the chord, or having the melody play non-chord tones, or just having a note in the bass line and really not much else. Things can be very sparse. You might have to work really hard for these harmonies to kind of flesh them out for yourself. But in this case, the chorus of Hurt is a lot more accessible, and that's not a bad thing. In fact, this is a beautiful example of how powerful a simple, straightforward chord progression can really be. There are a couple reasons why I think this chord progression works so well. One is just the chords themselves and their relationship to each other, which we'll go over in just a moment. Another is how they are actually voiced and arranged. And those are two separate things. So if we distill the chord progression down to its basic major and minor triads, what it's implying, six, four, and one. And that feels right to me. This feels like home. Now, interestingly enough, when we get to the full-on chorus where he sings You Can Have It All, there's no D major chord. One way you could explain it is that we go back to the relative minor and we stay there. But to me, it sounds more like we just don't get to go home. There is this feeling of incompleteness to this part of the chorus. And you could have it all. My empire of dirt. Bring us home, but no. I will let you. Oof. Seventh. And there's another reason why it feels like we're stuck there, and that has to do with the way that all of these chords are actually voiced, because they're not playing triads like I was. That was me sort of fleshing the chords out and bringing them back to their like original form before, you know, the real interesting expression has been added. Basically, that's like the skeleton, you know, which doesn't really change, or maybe even that's the whole body. And then the way that the chords are voiced are like the different outfits that the chord can wear. I don't actually know what to call this. It's a sort of a device that I've used a lot in my own music and even in my Nine Inch Nails like improvs, where I keep one part of the harmony consistent as long as I can and sort of explore the different points of tension that can be introduced while still communicating to the listener what chord I really mean. So for example, instead of this, he's doing this. That's enough with his vocal melody to imply this. Now the guitar is pulsing with the bass, but then there's this like constant sort of pad, and it sounds both like strings and an organ to me. And I'm gonna pull in a quote from the Song Exploder episode because he actually addressed that sound. It really does sound kind of like an organ. And the A and the E sort of end up being this like drone, you know, like the pedal tones. The little side note, when I play this, I really like keeping the E instead of fully resolving that chord, I like to keep the E, and then you end up with this sort of beautiful cluster of whole steps. Listen. Like I've become attached to that E and I don't want it to go. So. Especially there. Ooh, that's so much tension. Can you just hear? This note wants, this E wants so badly to go up to the F sharp. And it does. And we're left with one of the more fleshed out, accessible chords in Nine Inch Nails music. There's no, like, there's nothing missing. This is a full triad. It feels like the clouds have parted in that moment and all the sun is coming through. Here's another reason why I think we're in D major still, is because we're about to move back to B minor, and it sounds like a modulation. It doesn't sound like we're in the same universe anymore. I mean, doesn't that sound like we're in a new key? Part of it is because he's going to the major third, at D sharp. When he gets quieter and sings, "I am still right here," that's like the anti-climax of the song, which to me has just as much power, if not more, as the climax. To me, this is one of the most breathtaking parts of the song. You know, he's singing about these feelings disappearing while he slowly begins to disappear. But then he tells us, with like the last bit of strength that he has, that he's not. Now, this piano melody is kind of moving with the chords. So first we have the A. So the E in the piano is playing the fifth of that chord, that implied chord. Then it moves down to D, which is the third of the next chord. This is my favorite part. It goes down to the G, and instead of just going straight to the B, which would be the third of that chord, he hangs here for a moment. It sounds innocent, you know? There's something so, so tender about this. And the way it's sort of descending stepwise. So, you know, he didn't want to jump all the way down. He wanted to move step by step. Resolution. Now that's tense. This feels, that is like, that sounds like a child to me. You know, like starting here. Like realizing something, you know, growing up, accepting the truths of life, and then like going back to my innocence, only to fall again. And once, reaching even higher to fall even farther. thinking about whether there is actually any hint of the downward spiral melodic motif in this song, if anything sounds even a little like it, it would be this descending piano line. If you want, like this is some kind of callback to that, or this is a pure, innocent, you know, timeless version of that heaviness. In the second chorus, things really do hit some kind of peak because there's this note way down low and it's playing A. It's such an odd note to be repeating because, like I said, that's not a tonic note. In fact, it might just be the fifth. It's a very interesting note to choose, but at the same time, it makes sense because he's chosen to emphasize A and E already. And the way it begins to get quieter and become smaller when he's singing, "If I could start again a million miles away." And right at the end of that phrase, it comes back. And when it comes back, it feels so strong, like stronger than before. And then it recedes once again. There's something very tidal about this. Very last chord. I'm sure I'm not the only one that's always wondered, what is this chord? You know, what is happening here? The guitar is so loud that it dominates everything. Like he's losing a battle to something. A, D, B. So we're ending on B. That's where it all started.
I would find a way.
Like light shining through a dense forest canopy, he sings, "I would find a way," helping us to arrive at our final resting place, resolving to this major third of the key. This major third is, in most of my Nine Inch Nails analysis, represented some kind of hope and vulnerability and humanity, but sometimes it has also seemed to sort of symbolize mockery, you know, a mockery of or an inauthentic happiness because of the dark context that surrounds it. But here he really has truly found his way. This is so resolved. But at the same time, there is a note that is kind of stricken that reminds me so much of the sample in Reptile, playing the same scale degree. And that just loops and pulsates for such a long time. It felt so right to discover that the last thing we hear harmonically in this album is a tritone. And then the noise just stops and we're left with this hollow, decaying sound that we started with. Like I said, no beginning or end. We could start Hurt Over right here and it would sound almost seamless. This sound feels more like nothing, like not existing, even more than silence does to me. It's as if it were the static of the universe, right after we've turned off the show called Humanity.